John Amaretti, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars.
By Tom Young, who has over 400 career victories. The Redmen of St. John's, coached by Lou Carnesecca, who has over 325 career wins. Let's go downstairs to John Condit.
Here are the starting lineups for tonight's second game for Rutgers University. At the forwards, number 12, Chris Remley. Number 54, Steve Perry. At center, number 44, Andra Bell. And at the guards, number 10, John Battle. And number 24, Brian Ellerby. And the coach of Rutgers, Tom Young. For St. John's University, at the forwards, number 30, Willie Glass. Number 33, Ron Stewart. At center, number 23, Bill Whittington. Number 20, Chris Mullen. And number 24, Mike Moses. And the coach of the Redmen, Lou Carnesecca.
Rutgers 5-3, St. John's 8-1. Rutgers, no seniors on the entire squad. They start five juniors in the ballgame. And St. John's starting just one senior. That's Jeff Allen. St. John's with a definite advantage. They can use if they want to, both Whittington and Allen, as far as the height advantage is concerned. And here are the lineups right now, Rutgers and St. John's. Any notes on that, Bucky?
No, it's very definitely a very slender but quicker Rutgers team. St. John's a little more physical, slower, a little more solid defensively. The early going, I think, is going to be very important to Rutgers. This is not a confident team. I have seen them down 26 to Michigan from the Big Ten, and then I saw them come out and absolutely be awesome in the game against Seton Hall, where they just blew the Pirates of the Big East away. So when you have a young team that way, anything can happen.
Here are the officials. Ed Cartoto, Dick Paparo, Bob Diaz. Rutgers will use a lot of reserves, will they not?
Well, I think they're going to have to. I look for the inside game of St. John's to get them in foul trouble.
Rutgers trying to snap the string. They've lost their last five at Madison Square Garden. St. John's had won eight in a row till they lost to UNC at Madison Square Garden. Battle. And as it comes down, the Redmen on the move as Stewart got the rebound. This is Moses. Stewart looking for Mullen.
Perry is checking Chris Mullen underneath. That should be a good contest. They had to switch off.
Mullen is there for the rebound for two. Chris Mullen averaging over 18 points a game as we look at Lou Carnesecca.
Tonight is Lou Carnesecca's birthday. We have no idea the years, but it's his birthday. Chris Mullen wedging inside, going back up, doing what he's so good at, which is just kind of sliding in there without being a great jumper. He gets the ball, he gets it back in, he gets fouled.
So Bell on the foul. St. John's with a 3-0 lead. Ellaby.
St. John's in man, per usual. Play the ball tough, slough off. A lot of zone principles.
This is Perry from the side, Steve Perry. 6'6 forward. Score now is St. John's 3 and Rutgers 2. Moses with a good feed, but the whistle blows the play to a halt. As Moses was going down the line, that's what he's supposed to do, the penetration.
I think one of the questions for St. John's this year is that other guard spot. They definitely need a good point guard. Right now, Chris Mullen's doing most of the ball handling, which he's capable of doing, but it restricts some of the other things he does well. And you also have to wonder if they're going to develop any other consistent scoring beside Chris Mullen. But the inside game is definitely strengthened with the emergence of Wennington as well as he's played this year, and of course, Jeff Allen.
This is Wennington, and Perry, who committed that last foul, came over this time, knocked the ball away as they collapsed on Wennington that time inside. Wennington stands at 7 feet, 245-pound junior. Mullen, oh, did you see that? Moved under the hoop instead of going to the right side as they anticipated, he put it up left, Bucky.
Crafty, Ealy.
St. John's leading by a score of 5-2. The first minute and a half. Dell, Ellaby. Perry looking inside the Bell. This is Remley, he's a good shooter, and he trips. He tripped going over Stewart's leg.
Well, Stewart has got to play that a little smarter. Remley's right-handed. He's got to go out on the baseline side. And in this particular case, it was even more pronounced because Remley is right-handed. He went at him head-on, gave Remley the angle.
A miss by Battle. And the scramble, Remley. And here's Perry.
Perry's not fancy, but he has been impressive when I have seen him this year.
Wennington is down, and that right leg is going to be looked at very carefully. He is an obvious pain down there. In that scramble, looks like he may have twisted it coming down.
It looks like his left ankle. It was a very physical effort he made. He got two hands on the ball and basically, let's see if we can see what exactly happened. I believe the Rutgers player fell on the ankle. I believe that's what happened. When they hit the deck, his ankle was on the floor and the Rutgers player came down on top of it. We hope it's not serious.
So Wennington leaves.
Jeff Allen, number 22, is in.
And Jeff Allen makes an earlier entrance than anticipated. That's a tough break for St. John's, particularly for Wennington. He's played well this year. He's been averaging almost 14 points a ball game. Moses pops one and gets his own rebound. Looks like he was tackled from behind, isn't it, Bucky? And they say a backcourt violation going back and forth across the middle line.
Well, Moses missed. He hit the board, but he didn't get any of the iron on that shot. But the interesting thing is, against North Carolina on Thursday night in the finals of the ECAC Holiday Festival, when they were pressed, St. John's would not go to the basket, nor would they against Fordham in the first night of the tournament. But against the Rutgers press, they are attacking the basket and putting up the jump shot. And Lou Carnesecca teams don't usually do that. They must feel that they're stronger. At least Bell, they want to get down inside. Excuse me, Bob.
I was going to say, Bell keeps splashing in and out of there, and now he's come out to get the ball. This is he with the shot. Short. Willie Glass, number 30. Moses, 24. And Perry is sticking with Mullen. He just keeps on the move. Mullen is far away from the ball now.
Mullen posting up with Perry. Perry at 6'5", but very strong, very aggressive.
Oh, good play. Glass. But short on the shot.
Good weak side help by Rutgers that time.
Here's Perry, got inside. Good play. He elected to go to the right side of the hoop instead of going toward the closest side.
It reminds me of Jerry Hobby of Fordham in that he's got kind of a herky-jerky way about his play, but he's very effective and a very dedicated player.
Rutgers has taken the lead at 6-5. Oh. Perry has it and decides to shoot. That's what you call going around the rim, huh?
Chris Mullen not taking very good care of the ball that time.
Perry didn't wait for any help that time. He just said, I'll shoot. I don't care who's near the basket. Timeout is called as Rutgers has jumped into an early lead. Lead by three. And there's that ankle being looked at. We'll take more about that in a moment. Right now, it's Rutgers 8, St. John's 5, still early in the first half.
Know that over 250,000 import cars have been traded in on new Buicks? Buicks like our new front-wheel drive Century with more room and better mileage for less money than comparable Toyotas or Datsuns. No wonder Buick is the only domestic car with a sales increase for three consecutive years. Maybe you've bought one of those. Sooner or later, you'll buy one of these.
Wouldn't you really rather have a
Rutgers coming at St. John's with good man pressure. Chris Mullen, who normally takes very good care of the ball, a little careless there. Perry makes the steal, wisely pulls up because Moses had the angle. It's 1-on-3, but the one was Perry, and he put a little thrill in that one and used all of the rim. Remember now, the technical foul on the Rutgers bench, called specifically on the assistant coaches, is a two-shot foul. But remember this also, that all fouls on the bench are charged against the head coach, and should that total reach three, Tom Young will be watching this telecast from the locker room. So he is not immune from that total of three just because it was assessed on the assistants. Bill Wennington has left the bench and is headed toward the locker room. We hope he'll be back.
Rutgers 8, St. John 7 in the early going at the Garden. Moses. That was giving him a little room. He's slumping off him.
The way he's being played, Chris Mullen will take him down and try and rub off the post.
Glass on the miss. Mullen was hoping that time for a held ball. Looked like he and Remley were after it for a while.
It was really strange, Bob. Both of them fully extended with the arms. Neither one was jumping, both on their toes, and both had possession long enough to be considered for a jump.
Zucker has made his appearance for Rutgers. Ed Zucker. Moses is the man they motion to underneath.
Looked like Battle trying to post up down under there with Moses. Moses at 5'11. Battle at 6'2. It's not a great deal of difference, but it's an ego thing with guards, you know? You don't like to be posted down there.
Time, but the fast break emanates. A little off course in the pass to Stewart.
Again, the question, where is St. John's offense coming from if it isn't Mullen? That's the question I think Lou Carnesecca has to answer.
And Mullen was out early in the season with tendonitis for three games, but St. John's won, but the competition wasn't that rigid.
That was well said and mild.
Elevate. Rutgers leads by three. Rutgers has seen a lot of games in Madison Square Garden, as has St. John's. 55th game for the Scarlet Knights here. They've won 33, lost 21.
Ellerby now checking Mullen.
Stewart. And we have the block by the Scarlet Knights. Remley went over to help Bell on that play.
Turnabout is fair play. At the other end of the floor, Remley did the exact same thing to Stewart, driving baseline on him.
Followed by Chris Remley.
When the ball is thrown over the top of the defense and doesn't make the normal perimeter path back to the weak side, many times that defense gets caught. They're back in the lane trying to give weak side help. And when the ball goes right over the top, they're very vulnerable to the drive because they're coming from such a long way to get back out and put pressure on the ball.
Now Stewart's at the line. He too was out early in the season with tendonitis. In the lineup for Rutgers, Mike Brown, the tall and slender freshman. 6'10", 185 pounds from Wilmington, Delaware.
6'10", 185. That is slender.
Rutgers up by a point, 10-9. Score, time, 14 minutes to go, first half. Zucker. Battle looking inside. And Ellaby was double teamed by Moses and Mullen. Timeout is called at this juncture. As close as you can get to this point. Well, more coming up in a moment from Madison Square Garden. This is college basketball.
Madison Square Garden Cablevision presents the very best in sports and entertainment. There's exclusive coverage of all Knicks and Rangers games live from the Garden. And now, this season, there's also New Jersey Devils action from Byrne Meadowlands Arena. Boxing fans get to see today's stars, plus preview tomorrow's champs with professional boxing and the Golden Gloves. MSG Network viewers watch the non-stop action with wrestling, college basketball, and college football, while horse racing fans get action 7 nights a week. There are special events, including the horse show, the dog show, the renowned Milrose Games, tennis coverage that includes all 5 nights of the Virginia Slims Championships, and basketball's most historic title, the National Invitation Tournament. The network that brings legends to living rooms is more than live sports. There's diversified programming with the Avengers, Andy Warhol's TV, and the Jonathan Schwartz Show. See it all on Madison Square Garden Cablevision.
The Redmen at home in Madison Square Garden, an impressive record. Lou Carnesecca's personal record in this great building is 40-18. That's doing it, because normally when they bring a game in here, it's a big name opponent. We make the point again that St. John's pushing the ball up a little more, still not a drastic all-out attack against the press. There are two philosophies when you're pressed full court. One, you just get it in, walk it up, go to your set offense, or two, you attack the press. As you can see, they're back to business as usual, giving it back to Mullen, back to the guards, walking it up. When a team attacks the press that way, there's very little to risk by full court pressing them.
Redmen have played a lot of games here at the Garden, and Lou Carnesecca. Lou needs just 5 more wins. There's the block by Brown, and the follow-up missed. And this time Stewart has it knocked away. Rutgers almost lost it. Zucker and Remley. There's the score as Remley pays off with a 2-pointer. Lou Carnesecca needs 5 more wins to be St. John's all-time winningest coach.
There is a 45-second clock in this game. St. John's of the Big East, Rutgers of the Atlantic 10.
So Rutgers up by 3. Battle in the right position to come up with that one. And Ellaby.
Chris Mullen not taking very good care of the ball tonight.
Not so far.
Give some credit to Rutgers defense. It's very aggressive. And Brown, number 32 at 6'10", and a very slender 185, has become more and more assertive every time I've seen him play.
Offensive foul. He was an outstanding shot blocker in school.
Well, at this level of competition, though, he's going to need a few more pounds and a few more muscle fibers. Some of that's going to come with maturity, but you can be sure he's going to be in a weight room some this summer.
Moses bringing it down.
Really token pressure now by Rutgers.
Mullen still keeps circling. And again, the ball taken away
from Chris Mullen. That was a box and one. Ellerby matching up with Mullen.
Battle. Ellerby has it back.
When a jump shot's taken out there at 20 feet, you can almost bet that rebound's going to go out there almost to the free throw line. Too many rebounders run right underneath the rim on a long jump shot. It's never going to come off close.
This is Battle, the travel call. St. John's takes over. St. John's has had four turnovers to Rutgers two.
Sam Randolph, number 22, is in for the Scarlet Knights.
Chris Mullen
Randolph is in.
Chris Mullen has three that I can remember, Bob. That's like a game for him, maybe two games.
Mullen, Randolph is on Mullen right now, number 22. Moses. Rutgers leads 12-9. Stewart. Oh. Remley. Ellerby's pass to Randolph, a beautiful pass, but he couldn't scoop it up as we have the ball. Knocked off to the side there, and we've got the
sensational bounce pass that time to Randolph.
The foul on the play as Randolph goes to the line.
There's no question Rutgers playing inspired basketball. The last time down, Rutgers was not in a box and one. It was rather a 1-3 or diamond and one. But there's no question that four are zoning, and a series of people have taken Chris Mullen and tried to deny him the pass. And I think St. John's is going to see much more of this as the season goes on until they develop some more balance in their scoring attack.
And some defense that Rutgers is using on the Redmen. We're approaching the midway point, and St. John's is up with just 9 points.
Mullen trying to rub off the post. It's very physical down there. Mullen trying to post up the smaller Randolph.
Okay, they use a lot of energy, though. That's Allen going up. There's a whistle on the play as Allen banked it.
Sam Randolph is only 6'2".
Followed by Chris Remley. That's his
the junior from Trenton, New Jersey. Really staying with Mullen. Mullen trying to rub him off those posts. I know that's where he misses Bill Weddington, who, by the way, has not returned to the St. John's bench.
That basket was not allowed. This is Mullen missing on the rebound. Pulled down by Mike Brown. Remley committed that foul before Allen got off the shot. Perry partially blocked. And the Redmen come down on the 3-on-1 break. This is Stewart. They won't go.
St. John's really pushing the ball up the floor. They're taking the transition game.
Perry with his third foul. And Steve goes to the sidelines right now.
It's a very low score for 10 minutes and 43 seconds remaining in the first half. But it's not because of a tempo control of any kind. Both teams are playing very hard.
Perry, who is sidelined with three fouls, is the leading scorer to this point with 8. Mullen has a chance right now to top that, 1-1. He's got 7.
Tom Young still working on Ed Cartato.
Mullen, high score in the ball game with 9. Rutgers 13, St. John's 11. Still over 10 minutes to go in the first half. Remley in the corner. Randolph. And Zucker getting out.
St. John's in a 1-3-1.
This is Zucker, the lefty. Mullen, Moses. Chris Mullen. That was tapped back nicely by Allen to keep alive. And Allen. Mike Brown was in there to help out. Rebound pulled down by Remley. Ellaby feeding, and on the play, Zucker called on the foul.
With that 1-3-1, St. John's is employing one. They don't play the zone as well as they play the man. They're going to gamble some jump shooting from the corners. But that Zucker and Remley, who are in the corners respectively now in the deployment by Tom Young, both of them can hit that shot. But it's still theory until they do it. Good gamble by Luke Carnesecca.
Here's another 00, Eric Riggins, a freshman from Passaic, New Jersey. He's 6'8". In for the Rutgers team.
Good solid defense by Rutgers. Only two field goals so far by St. John's. Both by guess who? Number 20, Chris Mullen. Everything else from the free throw line.
And the Scarlet Knights for the lead of 13-11. We're past the midway point, first half. Allen, turnaround jumper. Glass. And he follows up. This time, Willie Glass has it. The 6'5 freshman from Atlantic City. And the whistle on the play as well.
Well, this is what St. John's is having to do. They're not having much from the perimeter on that first shot. Look at Glass come from the weak side. Second effort, third effort. When you give them three cracks that way, something bad's going to happen for you.
On the battle foul, Glass the chance now to give the Redmen the lead. It's tied at 13. Willie Glass. And Allen is there to pull it down. It goes in. Chris Mullen. A little off balance. Had the touch. Got the roll. There's Luke Carnesecca.
He saw the defense coming. Was sure he could get contact. And as it happened, the Rutgers player avoided him and left him hanging. He really put in a very bad shot that was really designed to get a foul.
Riggins. Ellaby. St. John's leads by two.
St. John's back to man. Feigenbaum on Remley.
Mullen, long pass to Glass, all by himself.
That was for David Russell, wherever he is. The man who is supposed to replace Russell in a massive rebuilding job for Luke Carnesecca.
Mike Feigenbaum is in the lineup. You can tell him with that heavily taped leg and the brace around his knee. Oh, look at that steal. Mullen passes the ball up. There's a three-on-one break. Glass goes up. Two more. And Mullen has spent both of these fast breaks. As Willie Glass has been the recipient, St. John's bolts into a lead of 19-13.
Luke Carnesecca has high hopes for Willie Glass, the 6'5 freshman from Atlantic City.
The Redmen have started slowly, but right now they're rolling with a six-point lead. 8:20 still to go in the half.
Get ready. Get set. Okay, let's go for the action. Aqueduct. Where New Yorkers go for a special brand of tough, scrappy racing. And the season is on right now. The Big Ape for action. You can bet on it.
Heavy duty price.
It's too expensive for me.
You got a deal.
Thank you, Payne Weber.
Someday, maybe next year.
I can hardly believe it.
Thank you, Payne Weber.
In this highly competitive financial world, Payne Weber believes the quality of life just might depend on the quality of your investments.
Thank you, Payne Weber.
Chris Mullen, normally known for his shooting, demonstrates here the good long pass, makes the steal. And this looks like a replay of a play just before. He throws the ball out in front of Willie Glass, who runs under it. Could have passed the ball to Jeff Allen, who was open, elected to go to the hole. The Big East Freshman of the Week last week, Willie Glass, 6'5", fine athlete.
St. John's has now scored 10 straight points, and Willie Glass at the line. Andra Bell has come back in for Rutgers. St. John's continuing to move out in front now with its biggest lead of 7 points. Ellaby, battle from outside. Rebound, up for grabs, and Battle has it back. Jackson is in the Redmond lineup. This is Bell short. Mullen with the ball. Mark Jackson, number 13, played so well in the Holiday Festival. Just a freshman from Bishop Lachman High School, St. Albans, New York, his hometown.
That was Coleman.
This Glass's second personal foul.
The second on Glass for an illegal block.
Yeah, trying to set some picks down there to shake Mullen loose. Tom Young, look at that. That's called, he's speaking to the official, and it had nothing to do with the Christmas card exchange. A little heat there. Young already has one technical charge against him.
Oh, under the boards, his Battle went up. Jackson went up with him. And the whistle as Stewart comes back in.
Good execution this time by Rutgers. Getting right down in the paint. Superb pass. Battle going back up. Only 6'2", taking the ball right back at the freshman.
Here's Battle at the line. Bucky, when we looked at Tom Young, brought to mind that you were an outstanding coach, but you lacked just one thing when you coach.
You're going to tell me the towel. Right?
That's it. Tom Young has the towel, John Thompson, Jerry Turcani, and Guy Lewis. You didn't have a towel.
No, and I didn't have Pat Ewing, and I didn't have Phil Sellers, and I'd rather have the players. The towels can take care of themselves.
2013. Feigenbaum.
Word from the St. John's locker room, Weddington injury not deemed to be serious. We may see him in the second half.
That was Riggins in and out. Feigenbaum driving, and the ball knocked out of bounds. Feigenbaum's dad, George, played in the NBA with Baltimore and Milwaukee, former University of Kentucky player. 22-13, Redmond. Battle coming up with the ball. And Battle on the drive. John Battle from Washington, D.C., where they put out so many great ball players. He went to McKinley High School there. Came into the game, leading scorer, over 19 points a ball game.
Mike Brown going to come back in for Rutgers. He really gave his club a big lift coming in for Andra Bell midway through the first half.
Jackson. Stewart in low, good position too. St. John's up by nine.
24-15.
Six and a half to go. Riggins, first half. And in the tug of battle for the ball, it's Stewart. Oh, look at this. We have beautiful penetration. Allen was the recipient of that excellent penetration. Now St. John's leads as their total amounts, 26-15.
I think Rutgers is surprised the way St. John's is pushing the ball up the floor. Normally, when you lose a possession against St. John's, you got time to get back and set your defense because they're not really looking to run. But tonight, the Redmen are pushing the ball up the floor, and that time they caught Rutgers with men back but not ready to play the D.
Ellaby in the corner. Battle has been held just to one field goal, and Ellaby to one field goal so far. Remley, short. None of these shots are short. Underneath, they get Jackson reaching in. You know, penetration is so important. Let's take a look at the last time.
Luke Carnesecca has high hopes for Jackson. Number 13, splits. Gives to Allen. That time Rutgers was back on defense, but nobody stopped the ball. And they enabled Jackson to split in there and create the overmatch underneath. Let's see if Mike Brown, number 32, the slender 6'10 front quarter from Rutgers, can pick his team up again.
Ed Zucker's also moved back in the lineup as Mullen takes it away, but he's got it. And now they say ball went out of bounds as Moses tried to contain it. St. John's has had some runs. 17-2 has been this run for the Redmen. Bob Rosen keeping our booth stats, and Jerry Taylor in the control unit. Here's Ellaby. And he spun it off the glass, and he gets it back for a third time. Puts it in.
Fundamental mistake there by Chris Mullen. It was his man that shot the ball, and he began to drift looking for an outlet pass, allowing his man to get back on, keep the ball alive, and eventually a Rutgers field goal.
26 St. John, 17 Rutgers, under 5 minutes to go in the first half.
It's still the box in one, triangle in one. Mullen working to rub off on the post with Stewart and Allen down there looking to help him.
That Brown has been guarding Allen from the front quite a bit, giving Allen a chance if they get it over. And that's Allen with the ball. He got inside for the 2 points. Brown was fronting him. They say no basket, an offensive foul.
Paparo calling the offensive foul on Allen. We expected to see St. John's try to go down in there more.
That's his first personal foul.
And probably would have if Weddington and Allen were both operative. Right now, Weddington is suspect in the second half after injuring an ankle early in the first half.
4.5 to go in the half. The miss by Battle, the grab by Moses.
Boy, Moses can jump.
Can he?
But he keeps that ball alive. Good point guards keep that dribble alive. It'll be interesting to see if St. John sustains this kind of philosophy of pushing the ball up the floor. They certainly didn't in the ECAC Holiday Festival. It could be they think that this is the way to play Rutgers, or it may be a very distinct philosophy change by Lou Carnesecca to try to get more offense off of transition.
Ellaby is now on Mullen. Pass inside to Allen. As they converged out on him, Allen was free.
Terrific ball movement by St. John's. They really swung it to the weak side. Dumped down.
28-17. See that Mullen uses up a lot of energy the way he keeps moving on offense, trying to get in position and get off the shot. They like to screen for him as often as they can. Remley, Rutgers shooting far off the mark. 3:20 left to go in the half. St. John's 28, Rutgers 17.
Ellerby still dogging Chris Mullen.
And who's going to grab it? Stewart does.
Timeout.
However, the whistle on that one, a timeout is called. So we've got 3:12 to go in the half. St. John's leading 28-17. You're watching college basketball from Madison Square Garden.
80 gold medal, we proved we were the best in the world. But time marches on. In 1984, we've got to prove it all over again. It's gonna take a lot of guts and a lot of money. The 1984 U.S. hockey team desperately needs your contribution. There isn't a minute to lose. Mail your gift to Box 1980, Lake Placid, New York, 12946. Or call 1-800-USA-1980, toll-free. The U.S. Hockey Gold Medal Fund is waiting for your tax-deductible pledge. Remember, when we won the gold medal last time around, they said it was a miracle. Let's have another miracle. Call 1-800-USA-1980 and help make it happen before time runs out.
Ryan Ellaby, number 24, 6'1", hits the back of the rim. This is the play, number 20, Chris Mullen starting down the floor, allowing Ellaby to come back on the offensive board, keep it alive. Lo and behold, he's back again, 1-for-3, and it all started because of a defensive breakdown. And that's one thing that St. John's normally does well, since they're not a team that likes to run and gun. They normally hang tough in there with 5 on the defensive board.
There's Weddington
with ice on that left ankle. The way he limped off, I would be very doubtful that he would be coming back. And if there's any question, Lou Carnesecca has to say, hey, I'm starting in the league next week. We won't take a chance.
Zucker looking for Battle, and Moses is guarding Battle. There's a travel.
No basket.
I can't begin to tell you how much difference there is in Mike Brown. We saw the game on December the 1st against the University of Michigan, and he was totally intimidated. He was blown off the court, didn't want to be there. It was the most timid guy I've ever seen. He came back against Seton Hall, was more assertive, and tonight, well, as that play indicates, he is just throwing his body at him.
He made the play, and Battle gets off the shot. The shots won't go for Rutgers, but they're getting the opportunities. That time he was very quick at jumping up to front the ball, get it before it reached the opposing center. Feigenbaum is going along the baseline back and forth, and Mullins, and that's Feigenbaum now in the corner getting the ball. Air ball. And it goes the other way.
Even though St. John's leads this game by 11 with 2 minutes and 18 seconds to go, it's still a crisp. If Chris Mullin isn't doing it, it's not getting done. He's either passing, shooting. The box and one looks like a defense that St. John's going to be seeing for a while.
Battle. Moses staying right with Battle. And that was Zucker and the whistle. Battle's been held to one field goal and Ellaby to two.
By Mike Feigenbaum.
Feigenbaum. In fact, the only big score for Rutgers is Steve Perry, who has come into the game averaging just 5.4. Tonight, Perry is 8. This is Zucker at the line.
Two shots.
Ed Zucker, a freshman, 6'7", 185 pounds.
I don't think there's a definite trend yet to say St. John's is a first-half team or a second-half team. In the first night of the ECAC Holiday Festival, they trailed Fordham at the half and came back to eke that one out, and they really had to work for that one. Went down to a jump shot with 2 seconds to go that could have tied it. And then the second night, they led number one North Carolina at the half and were thoroughly outplayed in the second half.
Well, we're under the two-minute mark now. St. John's 28, Rutgers 19. This Allen has continued to improve right through his collegiate career, Bucky.
Yes, he has. And Allen and Weddington are both well. St. John's has real muscle inside.
And Allen puts it in. There's a certain irony with Allen doing so well. He's a transfer from Rutgers. He played there in 79-80 season.
You think he wants to do well on that play?
He's doing it. He's got 6 points so far this evening. 30-19, a little over a minute to go in the half. They're really containing Battle and Ellaby. A lot of misses by the Scarlet Knights. Under a minute, first half.
Allen's taking over the lane.
And that was blocked by Mike Brown, but he came down on the arm.
That was inexperience. He was in great shape. All he had to do was hold his ground. If more big men would not think in terms of having to attempt to block a shot every time somebody came at him, they'd get more minutes. They wouldn't get into foul trouble, and they wouldn't be sending people to the line to shoot free throws when they have committed themselves early and probably are going to end up with a bad shot and may even charge you if you just hold your ground.
Feigenbaum comes from Lawrence, Long Island, is another transfer. He's a transfer from Ohio University. Michael Brown is out. Andre Bell is in.
Bell has not been effective so far.
St. John's 32, Rutgers 19, 50 seconds to go in the half. Thrown quite a blanket over Battle, who now has the ball. 2 points, averaging 19.4 coming into the game.
It appears that Rutgers is going to go down for one. Inside, Battle posting up again with Mike Moses.
Battle, now we're down under 20 seconds. And Bell. Cross court. Oh. They're down under 10 seconds now. Ellaby. Rebound, Feigenbaum.
There was a push. There was about a 6-second differential between the scoreboard clock and the shot clock. Rutgers took it down right to 1 second on the shot clock. There are still 5 seconds left in the first half.
Elevated the... they're just correcting the foul call. The official's gone over to the scorer's table.
It's a correction on the foul. The foul is by Mike Flagenbaum.
And I don't think we still have it completely straightened out.
Foul is called correct. The foul is on Mike Flagenbaum.
Now we've got it. Flagenbaum on the foul. We're down to 5 seconds. And with the 5 seconds left to go, we're getting another change for Rutgers. They're putting Ron Moses.
The foul is on Mike Moses.
Now another correction on the foul. It's now been charged to Mike Moses.
Well, when this happens, we have good officials here, but they really don't look very good with this kind of indecision. The crowd's letting them know about it.
Battle. That's his third point of the half. It's 32-20. 5 seconds to go in this half. Stewart. And intercepted. Remley goes up, misses. Remley again, and misses again, just before the half comes to an end. That's a tough way to go off. Psychologically, it would have been a good boost to get that steal and the shot and the hit. But that's the way that the half comes to an end. And so, at the halftime, it's St. John's 32, Rutgers 20. Have had outstanding records, not only this year, but in previous seasons. Rutgers last year, 23-8. St. John's last year, 28-5. You know, I recall a most unusual game with Rutgers some years ago in 1978. Rutgers played the only tie game at Madison Square Garden. It was an 84-84 exhibition with the People's Republic of China. And both teams decided there'd be no overtime. They leave it go right at that as a tie. Very unusual ending to a game. But this one will go to a climax, I can guarantee that. Right now, it's Rutgers that has to figure out how to get back in. And as you heard from Tom Young, one of the things they have to do is to make sure that Battle improves and his 1-for-8 performance. He's the big gun of the Scarlet Knights. Moses now making the inbound pass. This is Glass.
Let's see what adjustments St. John's has made now against the box and one.
Mullen starts on his move with Ellaby in pursuit. And under the glass as Allen went up. Falling back on him was Bell. And the foul committed by Bell.
The move by Chris Mullen to rub his man off against the stationary zone is creating that. Watch Allen now. He's going to try to help Chris Mullen, number 20, with a pick. And then as the defense slides over to Cope, Mullen is wide open in the lane. Two of them go with Mullen. He draws the crowd. Jeff Allen underneath draws the foul by Bell. Let's see if Perry can get it going again. Had such a good start. Got in the quick foul trouble. Number 54.
Perry was the only Rutgers shooter in the first half who actually shot over 50%. They had a total 0.267 shooting percentage in the first half, which is mighty, mighty low. Ellaby. St. John's getting those rebounds, not giving the Scarlet Knights a second chance. Stewart went up, the whistle on the play. Actually, Rutgers got off more shots in the first half than St. John's did.
It may be too early to say that there's a trend, but it appears that St. John's is going to come down the floor and attack the defense and not necessarily wait for Chris Mullen. It looks like they're going to be much more assertive. Rutgers getting good shots.
Two shots.
But the lid is still on.
Stewart shooting. Bell's foul was his third. St. John's has opened up a 14-point lead, and it's still 14. Yeah. 35-20. ball from outside. Short air ball. He is really off his form this evening. No question about it.
And give credit to St. John's defense. Especially Moses. Done a fine job on it.
And Allen. Now it's 37-20.
St. John's lead is 37-20.
You know, an interesting thing, Bucky, which is a little different, I think, sometime between colleges and pros with the timeout. If you're really going bad, should you keep going or feed it to somebody else or keep shooting until you actually get it back again? Well, we'll see what develops. Right now, you're watching college basketball from Madison Square Garden.
You start with a tough, crunching defense that never lets up. Then you add grace and power on offense in the forecourt, speed and playmaking in the backcourt. Mix in some new and old faces, and you can see why the New York Knicks have their fans excited. And you can catch all the excitement on Madison Square Garden Cablevision. Watch Hubie Brown and the Knicks live from the Garden as they match up against the best the NBA has to offer, all season long on Madison Square Garden Cablevision.
What makes it?
Mullen now over the top of the smaller LB, finding Allen inside. Beautiful execution without putting it on the floor. He turns, squares up, puts in a little 8-foot jump shot. To answer your question, Bob, right before that timeout, and by the way, Rutgers has used two. They have one remaining. St. John's has three remaining. One is not very many to go almost an entire second half. I think it depends who the player is. There are some who will shoot themselves back in. Other players, you know, if they miss their first four or five, forget it. It's not their night.
Glass. That's the third time that he has hustled down the court and gotten a long pass to put it in on the layup.
Well, resourceful St. John's. Instead of their usual tough half-court game, they've opened it up, and that's a little surprising because Rutgers was given the edge in quickness.
Oh, Battle's having a tough time. That one popped in and out. 39-20, the Redmen. Mullen. And the ball knocked out of his grasp. Allaby was over there, knocked it out of bounds.
A smiling Ed Cartato. I don't know if that call was funny, but he enjoyed it. It appears Mullen now is going to be the decoy.
Stewart, partially blocked, curls up for grabs.
Coming from the weak side.
This is 3-on-2 as they come down. It's hard to believe Rutgers has had any shooting nights, which looks more disastrous than this so far.
They're good shots, Bob. They really are. That's a shot Battle longs for.
At this stage, Battle will start having nightmares. It's just one of those nights for him so far. He's an exceedingly fine player and an excellent shot. Not tonight, so far. Perry, fast break, and Battle is there. He stuffs it.
Oh, there was some frustration in that one. He's been putting them up somewhere between 15 to 18, and they haven't gone for him. He made very sure of that one. Came close to hanging on the rim.
Good feed to Stewart. And Stewart was jostled as they converged on him across the way.
Followed by Steve Perry. That's
four.
Of course, the foul for Perry.
He just really hasn't had a chance to get into the flow tonight.
Perry with his fourth foul. Nobody else is more than... Well, there's one other with three. That's Bell, but nobody else is more than two on either side. Stewart at the line.
Perry was 4-for-4 in the first half. He played a total of 5 minutes. Gets his fourth very quickly.
You know, different teams of different styles. Some match up against others better, like boxers who are matched. The St. John's style seems to be giving Rutgers, in essence, a lot of trouble in every way.
You're very astute. And when the ball isn't going in, there's no way you can look good.
Remley. And he hits.
That was Chris Remley. And Remley lead 41-24.
41-24.
Full court pressure by the Scarlet Knights. Even Mike Brown is down. Full court pressing at 6'10".
Stewart across the lane. Ron Stewart. He has 9 points. Came in averaging just under six. 43-24.
Except for a few brief moments of a 1-3-1 zone, St. John's has stayed with their man for man, and it's their best defense.
Rutgers, an Atlantic 10 conference team. St. John's, Big East. Zucker got in close to the hoop.
St. John's leads 43-26.
Well, if Rutgers is going to make a run here, it's going to have to come from somebody other than Battle. And Perry, of course, who was hot, is sitting on the bench.
Stewart stands 6'8". He's being guarded by Remley, who's about the same height, a little taller. 43-26, the red men.
Rutgers now going straight man for man. And that leaves Brian Ellerby giving a good 4 inches to Chris Mullen underneath, and Mullen is posting. And that should be no surprise.
Mullen keeps moving in and out. He's on the far side away from the ball, coming to get it.
St. John's has had a nice balance of taking the quick break, pushing the ball up the floor with good judgment, and then being very disciplined in the half-court attack.
They roll in and out of that middle lane, and Mullen got it off, but the buzzer had gone off, the 45-second buzzer, and so no basket. Very infrequently does the buzzer go off, Bucky.
Yeah, but it's a testimonial to two things. One, Rutgers was playing very good man-for-man defense, and two, St. John's was not about to put up a bad shot. So it's not all bad, and especially when you have a 17-point lead, if you can consume 45 seconds, it's not all bad.
But here's Remley following. Tried to ram it home, couldn't do it. Allen has it. Up front is Glass. Another fast break by Glass.
He's going to set some kind of record for breakaways.
Yeah, he's sprinting up and down the court unmolested. 45-26. But why, Bucky, do they turn off the
Rutgers
in the last 4 minutes?
Well, I don't know. That's the rule. I would like to see it sustained, because that's when the game gets slow.
That's when a team has a lead, can hold it, and no clock to worry about. Just play slow up ball. That's when the speed up should occur. But apparently a lot of other people feel the other way.
Well, it's not over yet. That one's still experimental.
That's his second personal foul.
When it comes to the NCAA tournament this year, there'll be no clock.
Glass getting free. How does he get so free all the time?
Well, I think the Rutgers guards are getting caught underneath, trying to get down inside. And Allen very alertly just turned again without putting it on the floor, threw a frozen rope out there. Terrific outlet pass. For a team that doesn't run much, when Allen throws it, he throws a great outlet pass.
That's one of the arts of basketball you don't really hear much about, but making that outlet pass is all important. Oh, by the alley-oop, and Stewart goes up. Whistle on the play. Remley was over on it. So Stewart will go to the line. It's 45-26.
Followed by Chris Remley. That's Remley's third.
Slender Rutgers. A very young, slender team.
And the Scarlet Knights have 14 fouls.
But they're much improved over the early going.
Ron Stewart on the line.
Michigan absolutely destroyed them. 26-point differential at the half. And they came back and played with some courage. And that's when I first thought that Steve Perry was the key to that ball club. He came out mad, got him pumped up. They've been playing pretty tough since then. Look for Tom Young's club to get better and better as the season goes.
Well, they'll certainly have the benefit of getting more experience, not a senior on the squad. 45-26, the red men. The lead now at 20. Randolph, number 22. Middle is wide open. He's playing on the outside right now. Now Brown gets in there and was jostled as he did.
Brown really has to be open. Rutgers really doesn't look to give him the ball much. Well, he's been assertive on defense. He's still not a very confident player offensively.
Mark Jackson, number 13, who's in for the Red Wings.
Mark Jackson moves on the lineup now for St. John's. That foul was on Moses. This is Remley with the ball. 20-point lead for the Redmen. Ellaby. Whoop. Right off Zucker's leg as he was trying to go along the baseline. You know, this is the time that a team is faced with a problem. Rutgers actually has to start increasing the tempo of its game, and yet they have their pattern of play because they've got to keep shooting more and more quickly to erase a 20-point deficit, and yet this isn't the tempo that they play at, shooting as often as they can.
That's a good point, Bob. Perry's back in the game, down 20 with a little under 13 to go. Tom Young says, if we're going to make our move, we got to do it now, so let's don't hold him.
Allen and a follow-up by Stewart in the whistle.
St. John's methodically now controlling the clock. Good movement, good motion. And this has become quite a connection here. Mullen to Allen. There's the rub-off. Randolph, much shorter, trying to stay with Mullen. Finally catches up with him. And as a result of all the traffic in there, Allen is left with just enough opening for Chris Mullen to get him the ball, and then there's no way that Rutgers can contend with Allen underneath.
Dr. Glick gave an excellent medical analysis for you at halftime, and the word comes up that it's a sprained left ankle. Is that what you interpreted from all the medical terms?
Yeah, first degree, and although he won't play tonight, Dr. Glick seemed optimistic he'd be ready for the Providence game Saturday at home, so that's good news for St. John's fans. Perry again makes a cameo. Having fouled out, I don't give Rutgers much chance without him.
Well, Perry had the 8 points in the first half before fouling out, and that's it. And the oddity, Bucky, is that his 8 points is still a high for Rutgers in this game.
Well, that tells you what kind of night it's been for Tom Young and the Scarlet Knights. They shot 26% in the first half, and I don't think it's that good this half.
Allen now has 7 points. Well, let's see if he can continue to come alive here in the second half.
St. John's now content to just make the inbounds pass, walk it up, consume some clock, and go down inside.
And the seconds tick away. They lead 46-28. Jackson, ball slapped away, and he gets it back. But St. John's at this point can be poised, deliberate. And here's Glass putting it in. They're getting the good rolls, too.
Willie Glass
now has 13 points.
He's been getting most of them at the end of those down-and-out patterns.
That's
about
right.
35 yards in button hook.
Just what he's been doing, 4 touchdowns. Battle, shooting room. Hits again. That's 2 for 2.
Well, if he can go on a tear, maybe he can bring the Scarlet Knights back.
And that answers the question. If you're a good shooter, if you keep missing, keep shooting. You'll eventually get there. That's what Battle has kept doing.
Actually, he's done pretty well since he had that breakaway dunk shot. That seemed to break the tension.
Allen missed the air ball. Zucker got it. Up front, Battle, still with it. Battle lets fly. Rebound Randolph. This is Brown. He got the dribble, so he makes the cross-court pass.
Rutgers showing poise. They're not coming down and throwing up a wild shot, trying to force their way back in it. They've got plenty of time. 9 minutes and 30 seconds.
They're still playing their game. Battle has gone on the low post there. What do you think his chances are inside against Jackson?
Not good. I think Jackson's a little tougher physically.
Battle can't get the ball right now. He's trying to move in position. Randolph has it, and Randolph lets fly.
And the rebound by Glass. Giving it over quickly. Jackson, long pass to Mullen. Beautiful pass. That was practically a full-length court pass. And Mullen with the basket. The St. John's, again, is up to 20 points. 50-30, they lead.
And the foul is on Ed Zucker.
Opportunistic St. John's.
Three on Zucker.
Jackson lets it go. Not a very pretty pass.
Mark Peterson, number 50.
Chris Mullen, wide open underneath. Almost waits for the avalanche of red jerseys to draw the three-point potential play.
The foul was by Zucker.
Brian Ellaby, number 24.
Ellaby is back in. Randolph is out. Peterson has now moved in the lineup for Rutgers. Mark Peterson, a 6'9 freshman. Number 50. That's he with the ball. Mullen on Ellaby. Glass is on Zucker. And Battle still trying to get free underneath. They get him the ball. He fumbles it, picks it up, shoots, hits. Good play.
Boy, that was in traffic. He earned that one. He was wide open. Peterson had to put it on the floor, and by the time he did that, it was much more crowded in there.
Jackson. How will they call it?
Timeout.
They say it was touched, so they'll keep possession, and timeout is called. We have 9:38 left to go in the second half. St. John's 50, Rutgers 32. We'll be back.
Mitsubishi brings the turbo age down to earth. The new Tredia Turbo Sedan. With an electronically fuel-injected engine, specifically engineered for its turbo system. A grand comfort sedan with Mitsubishi turbo power for climbing, maneuvering. All at a down-to-earth price. The Mitsubishi Tredia Turbo takes you where you've never been before.
Rutgers in red with the ball. There's Battle posting up underneath. Peterson took one dribble too many. Battle was wide open. Finally gets a fork in it. Figures out where the iron is. Goes right up to sinuses.
And drills it.
Battle had a very frustrating evening, but he knew what he wanted to do with that one as soon as he got his mitts on it. Second half, Rutgers up to 30% after a dismal 26 in the first half. That's not enough to beat St. John's. That's not enough to beat almost any good college team.
You notice the games we've called, Bucky, the Holiday Festival, how few shots St. John's takes? We had that one game. They took 21 shots for the whole game. Went 16 for 21. Here, 6 for 9 in this half.
Judicious shot selection for one thing. Secondly, they really made a case out of going down inside. They've been on the free throw line a great deal. As a result, Perry is out of the game after only a few minutes. Luke Carnesecca has to feel pretty good about this. He's in control of the game. His starting center, Wennington, played exactly 2 minutes before going out with an injured ankle, and it is assumed that he has a chance to be back though on Saturday.
Reset to 37 seconds.
Tom Young, long night. This man, unless Rutgers just goes berserk, is going to have a birthday present. We did not determine the years, but today is the day.
And Luke Carnesecca was the 1983 Big East Conference Coach of the Year.
Thought I had a marvelous year last year. Mm-hmm. But they lost six people, three to the NBA, three starters.
That was Glass, all by himself.
And this team has much more work to do before it gets into the wars of the Big East.
Remley.
That was Chris Remley.
52-34.
52-34.
Conference play beginning in January. Georgetown comes in to play Seton Hall in the Meadowlands on Saturday. Also a MAC game in that doubleheader. St. Peter's and Manhattan.
Big schedules coming up, the Atlantic 10 and the Big East. Got a little playing under pressure right now at the Garden. Feigenbaum, he can shoot too.
Feigen, a nice looking stroke.
He does.
54-34.
Zucker. And who's going to take it? Jackson says, I'll take that ball. Mullen on the left side. They crossed him up. Glass was sort of looking toward Mullen as the ball went off his glass.
Mullen is at half court or beyond most of the time now, looking for that outlet pass. I haven't quite figured that out yet. He's releasing. It's a very uncharacteristic for St. John's.
Battle way up in the air and short, but he was hit. Luke Carnesecca has had a summer basketball camp. And Chris Mullen, as a real young boy, was one of his campers. So Lou has kept his eye on Chris for a long time.
That's a heck of a thing when you have people paying to give you an early start in recruiting. Well, the camps and the summer play, and a lot of the play in Europe has really helped our younger players. The real improvement is made in the off season, be it with the weights, with the jump rope, with the good competition. Actually, once the team season starts, most all of the coaching is designed toward team concepts. So the real individual skills, if they're going to improve, it has to be in the off season. Same with the body development. Weddington, for instance, a marvelous transformation. He's done a great job with the weights.
Ball behind the back, but right in the heavy traffic, Peterson. And as it comes down in the scramble for the ball, Battle. Ellaby with the shot. But the New Jersey players also play in the New Jersey Summer League. And a lot of the alumni from Rutgers come back. James Bailey and Roy Hinson, just to mention a couple. So they get a lot of year-round basketball playing together, which is the big thing.
It's important to play against people that are better if you're going to improve.
54-37 St. John's, 7.5 to go as Feigenbaum goes up and in. Nice move, wasn't it?
Rutgers went back to the box and won. It was really tissue paper.
Zucker. Oh, Allen comes down with it. This is Mullen. It's a 3-on-2 break. Let's see what Mullen does with the spin, the shot. Oh. He hits and he was fouled.
Again, Chris Mullen at half court waiting for the outlet pass, and he took a 1-on-3 break. Is he crafty or what? He just eases the ball without great speed or jumping ability. Just kind of gets it into the paint. Good ball fake. Gets you in the air.
He's just outstanding, and that's why he was the Big East Player of the Year last year.
And I thought the MVP in the ECAC Holiday Festival. But that's history.
I remember your statement. Well, we have 7:08 left to go. St. John's 59, Rutgers 37. From Madison Square Garden, this is college basketball.
When the U.S. hockey team won the 1980 gold medal, we proved we were the best in the world. But time marches on. In 1984, we've got to prove it all over again. It's gonna take a lot of guts and a lot of money. The 1984 U.S. hockey team desperately needs your contribution. There isn't a minute to lose. Mail your gift to Box 1980, Lake Placid, New York, 12946. Or call 1-800-USA-1980, toll-free. The U.S. Hockey Gold Medal Fund is waiting for your tax-deductible pledge. Remember, when we won the gold medal last time around, they said it was a miracle. Let's have another miracle. Call 1-800-USA-1980 and help make it happen before time runs out.
Chris Mullen in the lane with the ball. Good ball fake. Battle up in the air. No place to come down. Off the glass. Without any strain or pain, Chris Mullen does it effortlessly.
This program is authorized by Madison Square Garden Productions Incorporated solely for the entertainment of our audience and the publication, rebroadcast, or the use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this event, including the imposition of a charge for viewing the program without the express written consent of Madison Square Garden Productions Incorporated is prohibited. The announcers on this telecast were selected by Madison Square Garden Productions Incorporated. Out of bounds, off the leg. St. John's has outscored Rutgers 27-17 so far in this half. Lead 59-37.
Boy, Allen's hands are very good. He has also greatly improved. And I'm sure he feels a little extra pleasure in the fact that he had transferred from Rutgers, and his team and his performance tonight are both outstanding.
Big asset if you have a center, a tall center with good hands. You can really move off him on all sides. Jackson. That was tapped in.
Well, Allen now has 12 points. Weddington may have lost the job.
He's playing outstanding. Quick outlet pass to Jackson. On the left is Stewart. The trailer is Mullen. And he wisely passes it up as Rutgers was filling the lanes.
Chris Mullen on the bench, resting. The Johns comes back to action on Saturday with Providence at home, hopefully with a Bill Weddington able to play.
Stewart. You know, that ball handling aspect that you just touched on lightly is so important. For example, the championship Knicks, one of the great things, they had everybody handle the ball well.
It makes it a nightmare for a coach to prepare for you defensively. When everybody can pass and everybody can handle, you're really tough to defend.
You saw 00 Eric Riggins coming in. That's here with the ball. Ellaby. Battle. And Battle hits. Well, Battle, whatever it has been able to solve the problem here in the second half. Got off to such a slow start in the first. He now has emerged with 14 points.
What we have here are two teams that are very much in rebuilding years, coming off of good seasons last year and still trying to sort out who can do what under what conditions. It appears from this score that St. John's is a little further along, but I'm not too sure. Rutgers had many good shots tonight that wouldn't go down, and I think the box and one may be a very permanent thing in St. John's future.
That was Riggins finding the spot. Regardless of which team you root for, I think when you see a player have just a disastrous first half and then come alive, ball slapped out of his hands, it, you feel a little good inside for him. Coming to Madison Square Garden, big opponent, and looking around and knowing that you've had such a bad performance and then suddenly coming to life.
Well, it's a character test, too. You know, everybody's in a good mood when the ball's going in and things are going well, but when you have one of those frustrating nights, it's a pretty good measure of what a person, what a team is made of.
Tom Young, that we were just looking at with his ever-present towel in his 24th season as a head college coach. His 11th year at Rutgers, he's had 9 winning years and 1 year with a tie. Over 400 total wins. This is Allen.
He has been to the Final Four.
Mm-hmm. 1976, his regular season, he was undefeated, 31-0 before losing.
Yep, he was there.
At 400 total wins, that's more than you had, Bucky, I'm sure.
Yeah, he's in it about 16 years longer than me, too. And I have no regrets.
63-41. Campbell has come on the scene. Darren Campbell, number 30. Another one of those players from Washington, D.C., McKinley High School, another freshman. This is Zucker. And Riggins.
That sort of typifies the Rutgers night.
Oh, what a low shooting percentage they've had.
26 in the first half, and at last check, it was only 30 in the second half. You got no chance, especially against St. John's and Madison Square Garden. So Rutgers is going to lose their advantage. They led this series 7-5 coming in. It's going to go to 7-6.
Number 44 is Bob Antonelli in for the Redmen.
Timeout.
And a timeout is called. Well, we're coming down the home stretch of this game right now. 3:57 to play. St. John's with a hefty lead.
Of the best-selling motor oils today, 14 now save gas. But only one saves gas. Offers cold weather starting down to 35 degrees below zero. And the best engine protection under extreme heat. In fact, the best engine protection you can give your car. Only one. Mobil 1.
Hey, New York. Gold Ohm gives you more than the average of the money market funds. In the last year on the same investment, Gold Ohm's Golden Access account paid more. $402.50.
Here at Madison Square Garden, a
at the kilometer scene.
Yeah, if you're shooting at 26%. There has to be some bright spots in the building, and that happened to be one of them. They've played five times in Madison Square Garden, and are you ready for this? This will be the first time, if St. John's can hold on to this lead, that the Redmen have beaten the Scarlet Knights here. And that, I think, would surprise a lot of people. It surprised me.
Well, there are 3:52 to go to make that come true, and it appears to be very imminent. 63-41.
They met last year in the NCAA tournament, second round. St. John's won by 11 at the Hartford Civic Center.
Mullen took that ball away from Mike Brown, who was trying to get the pass out. 3.5 left in the ball game. The Redmen in quest of win number 9 against one loss. Rutgers 5-4. This game comes to an end.
Either there's great respect for Rutgers' ability to come back, or Lou Carnesecca is trying to build a little conditioning into Chris Mullen, who tired in that ECAC Holiday Festival final against North Carolina, but it's always a risk at this point in the game.
And it's grabbed back by Riggins. Number 14 is Steve Brown. Number 14, a freshman. Oh, look at that reject, will you? Stewart batting the ball away.
Oh, he got that at eye level, too. It almost didn't get out of the shooter's hand. Zucker always takes the ball to the basket. Very aggressive freshman.
Some of those Rutgers players on the bench just hoping that they can get a chance to move in the game. Mullen, beautiful pass for Moses. Fine pass. Mullen now is 18.
That one is as advertised. Came back to St. John's after a superb high school career here and a good career at the University of Florida. Takes a little while to adjust.
And that ball was put on the ground by Brown and lost off his leg. They come down with a man advantage. Moses feeds Mullen again. Hey, that's a pretty good tandem they get going, isn't it?
I'll tell you, Lou Carnesecca is going to have to look at this tape and say, hey, we're pretty good fast-breaking team.
That's 20 points for Mullen. Stewart is 10. Allen is 14. Glass 15. Feigenbaum is 8 for Rutgers. Battle 14. Ellaby 6. Remley 6. Perry 8. Riggins 2. Zucker 4. Randolph is 1. And now some of those fellows have been sitting patiently on the bench saying, look, I'd like to get in the ball game if at all possible. It is possible. Peterson will make the inbound pass.
Makes that substitution of by Lou Carnesecca, putting Chris Mullen back in the game. It was 18 points at that time. And in a minute and a half, they ran it to 26 points. And now Mullen is out. I feel confident for the evening. As a coach, you just want to die if your horse sprains his ankle at this point in the game with a lot of reserves in there.
This is 3-on-1 on this break. And Glass goes up. Oh, what a play. What a play. You see that alley-oop on the run? Willie Glass. He's the first.
The running Redmen, Bob Wolf, they are looking good.
And tapped in.
And that was Steve Brown.
This game fooled me. I thought it would be much closer than this.
Last bucket by Brown. Steve Brown makes it 69-43. Went down to a minute 20. This Glass looks like he'd be on the Olympic sprint team going down court, doesn't it, Bucky?
Yeah, he's got a lot of physical equipment. He appears to me to be further along than David Russell at the same point. Russell did not improve appreciably as a freshman on through his career. You know, he really did the same things and he did them a little better, but the parts of his game where he wasn't strong really didn't come as I expected them to over the course of his career. Glass is the same kind of athlete. And we'll see if his outside shot, ball handling, and all of those other things that go with the run and jump and the strength will come along. They should. He's going to have good coaching.
It's been a tough night for Tom Young, who's an outstanding coach with a young team building this year, getting experience. This is Steve Brown, and on the foul by Antonelli, Steve Brown is fouled. That stops the clock with 44 seconds to go. St. John's with a very convincing win, 44 seconds away from culmination. They lead 69-43. And in the first game tonight, Louisville defeated Iona 93-81. Well, who's going to get the last basket? Moses goes up. Still scrapping for it. Oh, he took a nasty tumble. Oh, man. He went down hard.
This is a very difficult time of the game because people are coming off the bench cold. They're trying to look good, and it's normally rather chaotic. It's a very good time to be injured.
And this is one of the plays where actually there was very little at stake, just to show actually his personal spirit as he came down as hard as he did.
We would like to wish somebody a happy birthday here tonight.
Here's the announcement.
Lou Carnesecca.
John Condon announcing Lou Carnesecca's birthday. You had the big scoop on that, Bucky.
Oh, yeah. Got all the pertinent information about Captain Quinn, the SID of St. John, shared that with us.
Thanks to Bob Rosen, Jerry Taylor for their statistical help. We're down now to 22 seconds. St. John 62, Rutgers 43. And a little happy birthday chant in the background to Lou. Moses. Oh, intercepted by Allen. He intercepted the pass right there. Just put out the hands, grabbed it. We're down to 4 seconds. And that is it. Ron Moses, the Rutgers player, getting off that last shot. St. John's with a very convincing win over Rutgers University. So that's the way that it went in the second game. Final score, 71-43. This